going to go ahead and open the public hearing on House Bill 133 and call the prime sponsor, Representative Itzy. He's not here. Representative Corrigan, would you introduce the bill, please?
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. I was actually planning to speak against the bill, but I'd be happy to introduce it on behalf of my friend Representative Itzy. This is House Bill 133, an act relative to a jury's determination as to the applicability of law. Yes, that's the right one. And it's we had what we call the jury instruction bill, sometimes called the jury nullification, and this puts and right now it just says that the court shall inform the jury of its right to judge the facts. And then this adds some language, which I believe is the so-called Wentworth instruction. The Wentworth instruction dates back to the case of Wentworth versus New Hampshire, which was one of the defendants at the Seabrook nuclear power plant about 40 years ago. And he was involved in a criminal trespass case. So that's and it's telling people if you have a reasonable doubt on whether the state is proved anyone more of the elements of crime charged, you must find the defendant not guilty. However, if you find the state has proved all the elements of the offense charged beyond a reasonable doubt, you should find the defendant guilty. Even if you find the state has proved all the elements of the offense charged beyond a reasonable doubt, you may still find that based upon the facts of this case, a guilty verdict will yield an unjust result and may define the defendant not guilty. You know, although I suppose you all have copies of bills in front of you, that's maybe not entirely necessary. Anyway, that's HB 133. And let's see where the Itzy is here.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Representative Itzy, please take a seat.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Okay, for the record, I'm Representative Danis. I represent Rockingham County District 10. Town of Fremont, and if memory serves me correctly, this is regarding jury instruction. This bill attempts to correct what happened as a result of the legislation we passed back in 2012. In 2012, we passed legislation that authorized defendants or their attorneys to inform juries of their power to ensure that justice is executed. That happened a couple of times, and then that instruction ceased to be functional. What this is, rather than allowing the defendant or their attorney at the normal instruction phase of the trial, this informs the judge of what we want the instruction to look like. The first part is simply the Wentworth decision, and then it is followed by an added sentence which states, if you find that the state has prove the elements of the offense charged beyond reasonable doubt, you should find the defendant guilty. That should. And it's the difference between should and shall in the first sentence that is often lost on the jury. Even if you find that the state has proved all the elements of the offense charges beyond reasonable doubt, you may still find that based upon the facts of the case, a guilty verdict would yield an unjust result. You may find the defendant not guilty. It's a very important concept. We make laws that are generally applicable to the general public and us as well. We are not, I don't believe, so wise that we can craft laws that are necessarily applicable to every, perfectly applicable to every situation in which they might in fact apply. There are specific circumstances that make that problematic. This reminds the jury that they have, and have always had, the common law power to say, despite everything, this is not what we want done in our name. It makes sure that in those fringe cases that our laws do not accurately apply to, that the jury has the power to do what is right. Yes, we are a nation of laws, but in the application of those laws, we must ensure that justice is not forgotten. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Senator Lasky has a question, then Senator Hennessy.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Good morning, Representative.
Thank you.
If I understand you correctly, this is then based on the premise that jurors don't know the difference between shall and should.
Not know the difference. When you're being read the jury instruction, the first part says, it is the criminal, in the criminal, okay. If the jury, if you have a reasonable doubt as to whether the state has proved any one or more of the elements of the crime charge, you must find the defendant not guilty. However, if you find that the state has proved all the elements of the offense charged beyond reasonable doubt, you should find the defendant guilty. It all rests on how much emphasis the person reading that instruction puts on the word should. And I'll give you an example. The word ought. You think you all know what the word ought means? You think generally in our society now, we think it's kind of similar to should, but it's not. The word ought is the highest possible instruction that there is. It is duty. It is that which must be done because it is the right thing to do. Yes, we often miss the subtleties of the English language, and we need to ensure that the jury is well aware of its power to ensure that justice is done.
Thank you.
Are there any further questions? Senator Hennessy.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you, Representative. In following along that previous line of thought about definitions and interpretations, it feels to me a little bit as though unjust is one of those words as well. And I'm wondering if maybe you could give us an example of when this would be something that would be applied.
Absolutely, and it's actually an example that then Chairman Rowe used last term when this bill came out of the House. At the conclusion of the, I believe it was the executive session, he said, imagine you've got an elderly husband and wife, and the wife is suffering from stage 4 cancer. And she begs her spouse to give her more than the recommended dosage of her pain medication because she's in such excruciating pain. And he complies. And as a result, her breathing stops. And there is a trial. And did he, in fact, do something that could be considered murder? And the answer is, yes, you could construe it to be murder. But would it be just to put this individual who has made the painful decision of putting his spouse at risk because he was seeking to alleviate her suffering? Is life imprisonment, or even any imprisonment, a just result?
Yes, hold on. I'm sorry. I'm just looking up the statute.
Oh, that's okay. Thanks. So it, as somebody who believes that it's too bad that husband does not have that right, and that end of life issues are something that we need to deal with and come up with just or fair or sensible solutions, which I am that person. I do, however, wonder if that is not asking the jury then to make an ethical decision rather than to make a legal decision.
Mm-hmm. Historically, the jury is the trier of fact. And are the facts presented? But one of the facts can be, does the law apply to the situation? I'll give you a good example. Fortunately, the judge in this case, at least for a period of time, there were different judges, did the right thing. We had a family that was in controversy with DCYF. And they had had a hearing, and they anticipated an adverse result of the hearing. But before the hearing, before the issuance of the order or opinion, they left the state. And our county attorney at the time decided he wanted to prosecute them. And so first he tried to get them extradited for having taken their daughter out of state. And that was a misdemeanor in Massachusetts, said go fly a kite. And eventually what he did was construe our parental interference laws, which can at that time could only be reached through a divorce. You could only apply them when it was one parent in a divorce interfering with the rights of another parent in divorce. These two individuals, A, had never been married, B, never divorced, and they were doing this together. But if under those circumstances you take the child out of state, it becomes felony kidnapping. And using that misconstruence, he got Massachusetts to extradite the family back to New Hampshire and proceeded to charge repeatedly, and there were seven or eight cases successive for felony kidnapping. In all of them, the judge said, no, the law doesn't apply to the situation. Eventually, one of them was found guilty for criminal contempt, but not for the underlying charge. We need to ensure that the jury, if they see the law doesn't apply, regardless of whatever else does or doesn't happen, if they see the law doesn't apply to the situation, either in fact or just because it's going to yield an unjust result, it's not what we as a community want to happen. Historically, they have that power, and we need to make sure they know that they have that power.
Senator
Gannon. Thank you, Madam Chair. Good morning, Representative. How are you doing today?
I'm well, sir.
Good, thank you. Just two questions, if you can help me.
Sure.
So just results are what we're after, right?
Mm-hmm.
Isn't there already a process here, the court and equity? The judge himself, he can have judgments notwithstanding a verdict. He can throw away a jury's decision in equity himself already, right? Don't we already have a safety valve?
The judge can, but that's not the will of the community, so to speak. That's why we have a jury. A jury is justice by our peers. Whatever the legislature may pass, do our peers think that the application of the law is just, as opposed to resting on the opinion of one individual?
Madam Chair, one more question.
Yes.
Thank you. Representative, I have a little problem on line 14, the word may. I'm afraid that similarly situated individuals are going to be treated differently. In one day in one court, you're going to get different results with the exact same case, where the word says may. I trust more in the judge in a situation like that.
Well, you may trust more in the judge.
I
trust more in the people. But
the word may, we'll go back to that.
Okay, but the word may, it's because it is a judgment call by the jury. They have that power, but it's their judgment as to whether they feel it's an unjust verdict. It's a permissive power, not an absolute instruction. If you want to amend the bill to say shall, I guess you're free to, and I probably wouldn't object, but it isn't where I would go.
We're good, yeah. Thank you. Thank you,
Senator French has a question.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you, Representative. I have seen this jury nullification work quite well in the court systems before. So it has been used recently in the past. Why do we need clear statutes such as this in order to continue to use it in the future?
Because the law as we passed it in 2012 has not been universally applied or amended.
That's it.
Right.
Thanks. Okay. Senator
Gannon. Final question. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Representative, for indulging. So basically, you want the jury to be trier of fact and trier of law. Traditionally, I think of them as the trier of fact, and I think the judge, I think most people would, most jurists would think of the judge as trier of law.
In the end, traditionally, the jury always was the trier of the law as well. And in a limited sense, very limited sense, they're still the trier of the law because they are the judges of who gets put in office and makes the laws. This might be applied in a situation where you have an archaic law. And we, the legislature, have not yet been so wise as to amend the law, but the will of the community, the sense of the community, is something different than what we have seen fit to correct. And also, just remember, we make a law that's static to apply to the vast majority of cases. We may be perfect in application to 99.9% of the cases that come before the bench. What about that 0.01% where the law is not adequate to the task? Because we're not all wise.
Thank you.
Okay, are there any further questions? Representative, I have a couple of questions. In your testimony, you said that the law that was passed back in 2012 has ceased to be functional. And in response to Senator French, you had said that the problem is that the court is not applying it universally in every instance. What makes you think that passing another law is going to force the court to obey this when they're not obeying the law that was passed in 2012?
Well, hopefully,
please, sir, if you're going to talk and have a conversation, please go out in the hallway. We can hear you up here. It echoes in here. So please, if you're going to have a conversation, take it outside the room. Thank you, and I apologize for interrupting your testimony.
No problem. Functionally, ideally, if we see a pandemic of the judges not following the law as we pass, we should do something about it. But one of the things that was an attempt in this legislation is judges with reason like to control the flow of what happens within their courtroom. It's different than the legislature. In the legislature, we have very little control of what actually happens momentarily. But the judge has plenary control of his courtroom. Mm-hmm. Rather than simply making it instructive that he's supposed to allow an instruction of whatever form. There's no real limitations on what the defendant or his attorney may set before the jury. We thought it would be more useful to put it in the hands of his judge, in the hands of the judge, telling him what we believe the powers of the jury to be.
Do you have any kind of statistics or numbers that can tell us how many times that this has happened, where the jury did not receive instructions?
No, I cannot. I can only tell you that after we passed law in 2012, there were some very visible applications of the then jury nullification power or statement. And as a result, and I could go back and find them for you, I know that certain individuals were not allowed to give that instruction.
Okay, and that would be great if you can
I will dig that up.
That information. And do you know if any complaints have been filed?
I do not know.
Okay.
I would assume that there were, but I would complain if I wasn't allowed to. I have no idea how it was handled.
Okay. Okay, thank you very much. Are there any further questions? Seeing none, thank you very much, Representative. The chair will call Representative Morgan.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. I continue to be Representative Timothy Horgan, Representative Stratford County, District 6, Towns of Durham and Banbury. And I did write the minority blurb against this bill when it went through the House. And basically, so jury nullification, the power, that's something that's existed, existed since the dawn of our legal system, because in a criminal trial, a not guilty verdict by the jury is not appealable, and hence it effectively gives the jury the right so they can acquit somebody for any reason they want, and there's no appeal from it. So that's where the concept of jury nullification comes from, and I think certainly I don't want to change that. This bill modifies amends a bill that was passed in 2012. It changes the title and adds, as I said before, something called the Wentworth instruction to the bill. And I think it is a good thing that acquittals and jury trials are not appealable, but I'm not sure that we should be encouraging juries to disregard the law, that they should be applying the law as it's written. I know we tend to look at cases where you have sympathetic defendants, certainly with drug laws but it can also be used to find defendants that some people find unsympathetic. It could have there's like cases like we've had thankfully not New Hampshire, but we had, for example, a number of cases where law enforcement officers have killed unarmed citizens for what seems like no good reason. So jury might nullify those cases just because they're sympathetic to law enforcement. And then sometimes it's even hard, tell like what a jury will find, who they will find sympathetic or not. Like residency referred to something which was the subject of a House petition back in House Petitions Redress, which was the Katz-Krogman petition. And the Katz-Krogmans were a older couple. Actually, some of the facts, it's unclear that they may in fact have been married. They've been together for years. Anyway, without going into the whole thing, which is a very long, convoluted, sad story, a jury probably would be sympathetic to Mr. Katz and Ms. Katz and Mr. Grodman, because they were certainly caring parents who maybe made a lot of decisions that didn't work out too well. But they may have also been unsympathetic to the defendants because they did have a history of really questionable litigation. They filed a number of very strange lawsuits, almost all of which had failed. So you don't really know how the jury's going to feel about it. So it's probably best to ask them to be dispassionate about it and judge the law the way it is. And then you can deal with the other issue in the sentencing trial. That particular case, the Katz-Krogman case, I don't think they ever had a criminal jury trial. I think those things were all decided by the judge, if I recall. But that's probably like neither here nor there, although there is a voluminous file probably hidden somewhere over in the other thing about the petition. The Wentworth case, just to finally say, actually dates back to 1977, so that was long before jury nullification, rights of accused, or jury destruction statute, whatever you want to call it. That's long before the statute in question was passed. And so Wentworth was a defendant in criminal trespass trial involved in the protests against the secret nuclear power plant. And certainly, I would consider him, from my point of view, he would be an extremely sympathetic defendant. But
And so they did suggest this instruction, and I think, I'm not sure this is something that can be hardwired into the law, so I think it's instruction that, although it's has been used over the decades a number of times, it's stood the test of time, I personally still think there's some issues about this. I don't think the statute of question needs to be changed. And certainly there's, you can't really, there's not much you can do to convince, you can't stop the defense attorney from making this argument anyway. You're pretty much a defense argument, or a defendant appearing pro se is pretty much free to make any argument in court they wish. So I don't think you can stop them. So I think probably, you know, we should encourage juries to obey the laws. And as I said, it's not just the sympathetic defendants you can benefit from, it could be the unsympathetic defendants. And lots of cases, some jurors will find the defendant sympathetic and some will find him unsympathetic. So I would urge you to find this bill HB to legislate and keep HB ARSA 519-23A the way it is.
Okay, thank you very much, Representative. Are there any questions from the committee? Seeing none.
I think that's the
court. Oh, Senator Gannon.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm sorry. Thank you, Representative. I'm interested in the bill a little more than I thought I was the more we talk about it. Don't you think this would act as a double safety valve? So we have the judge, as I talked about earlier, could throw a case out for a judgment notwithstanding a verdict, an equity thing. Wouldn't this just be a double safety valve in case justice isn't happening? Do you not trust the peers, the jury of your peers?
I trust them, and they do have the right to acquit the defendant for any reason they want, and that's the way it should be, but I'm not sure whether adding this language will help them in that job. So again, thank you.
Thanks.
Okay. Are there any further questions? Yes. Seeing none, thank you very much, Representative. The chair will call Elizabeth Woodcock.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. For the record, my name is Elizabeth Woodcock. I work for the Attorney General's office. I'm here to oppose the bill. I have written testimony that I'm going to submit to you, but I wanted to make a couple of quick points in addition to what I've will have submitted in writing for you. The first is that if you look at the preamble of the bill that says that the jury is the only means for, I have the language written down here, the only location for this consent to law is the jury. I think that that's wrong. If you look at Part 1, Article 12, the location for this consent is here. It's you. Part 1, Article 12 talks about the duly elected representatives. And you're the people who are supposed to be responding to the will of the people of New Hampshire. That responsibility is not given to a jury. Juries are not elected. They are selected through a voir dire process. There are efforts made during that questioning to make sure that the jurors are not coming forward with particular biases or something of that nature. But they're not elected. And they are juries of peers, but they're not elected by the people of the state of New Hampshire. And that's what Part 1, Article 12 is talking about. The second thing that I would point out, and I quote it in my remarks, is that the Supreme Court came out with a decision not too long ago, the Paul case, and it was interpreting RSA 519-23-A, and it said, and I have this quoted in my statement, finally, construing RSA 519-23A as merely codifying an existing law rather than conferring on the jury a right to judge or nullify the law is consistent with the doctrine of constitutional avoidance. This well-established doctrine requires us, the New Hampshire Supreme Court, whenever reasonably possible, to construe a statute so as to avoid bringing it into conflict with the Constitution. Were RSA 519-23-A interpreted to grant juries the right to judge or nullify the law, there would be a significant question as to its constitutionality. Now, I cannot tell you that the New Hampshire Supreme Court would rule that the proposed legislation is unconstitutional. I don't wear a black robe. I'm not sitting across the river in the New Hampshire Supreme Court. And were the legislature to pass this, the Attorney General's office would be responsible to defend it to the best of our ability. But the New Hampshire Supreme Court doesn't usually use language like that when it's interpreting a statute. And I think that this committee would be well advised to take a careful look at that opinion. The final thing that I wanted to say, and it's in response to what Representative Itza was talking about. He talked about a small minority of cases where the courts refuse to give the instruction that was approved in the RSA that was adopted a few years ago. One of my duties over across the street in the New Hampshire Attorney General's office is to handle appellate cases. If a court refuses to give an instruction, that becomes an issue that a defendant can raise in his direct appeal. Every person who is convicted of a criminal case, no matter how small or no matter how insignificant, is entitled to a direct appeal. The Attorney General's office handles all of those appeals. If a court refused to give an instruction as required by the RSA, I cannot tell you, because again, I don't wear a black robe and I don't sit across the street, I cannot tell you what the New Hampshire Supreme Court would do with that, but I suspect that the New Hampshire Supreme Court would take a very dim view of a judge who refused to instruct as required by the RSA or by the court's case law. I have been handling appeals for almost 9 years across the street, and I have not seen an appeal involving this RSA. I think I would be aware of it, even if I hadn't handled the appeal myself. I think I would see it in a published or an unpublished opinion, and I just haven't seen it. So I'm not sure that this pandemic that Representative Itza was talking about really exists. I think that the judges, the people of New Hampshire are enormously fortunate in the people who take the responsibility of sitting on the bench. I've practiced in a number of different districts, and not every single state or district, because I did practice in the District of Columbia, has the high quality of people on the bench that the people in New Hampshire have. Lawyers can, believe it or not, make more money than they make taking the responsibility of becoming a state court judge. And the people of New Hampshire are enormously fortunate in these public servants. So I would encourage you to have some faith in the people who take the oath to serve the people of New Hampshire, just as I think the citizens of New Hampshire have faith in all of you.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Are there any questions? Seeing none, thank you.
I will hand up this written testimony.
Give it to our secretary.
Thank you very much for your time.
The chair will call Daryl Carey.
Daryl had to step out for another hearing.
Okay, thank you. Okay, the chair will call Howard Zibel.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Good morning, members of the committee. The court has no position on this bill, because if it passes, it would likely come before the court on a constitutional challenge. So I'm here to explain what the issues would be if this bill passed and it would come to the court. One of those issues arises under state versus county. That was a 2014 case. 167 New Hampshire, 161, page 161 is the site. And it kind of dealt with separation of powers, the boundary between court rules and statutes, a boundary which has changed over the past 25 years. And in Carter, the court held, last line of the case on page 170, statutory enactments prevail over conflicting court rules unless those enactments compromise the core adjudicatory functions of the judiciary. So the issue that would come before the court were this, were House Bill 133 to pass, is whether this statute compromises, right in the jury instructions, whether that compromises the core adjudicatory function of the judiciary. I can't answer that. I don't wear a black robe. Only the court can answer that. What I can do is give you some background. You've already had some of it, so I'll try to be very brief, on the jury nullification instruction. It's not a court rule, as you've heard. It came from the 1978 case of State v. Wentworth, which you can find in 118 New Hampshire, 832. And Wentworth, as you've also already heard, just has the interesting factual background that it arose out of the demonstrations at the Seabrook Nuclear Power Plant a couple of years or 1 year earlier. And the court, in its power under the Constitution, Part 2, Article 73A, and in its statutory power, the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court, in 490, Section 4, required the following jury instruction. And I'll read it, it's only a couple of sentences. The test you must use is this. That's the judge talking to the jury. The test you must use is this. If you have a reasonable doubt as to whether the state has proven any one or more elements of the crime charged, you must find the defendant not guilty. However, if you find that the state has proved all of the elements of the offense charged beyond a reasonable doubt, you should find the defendant guilty. And this is where you've heard testimony of the subtle distinction between you must and you should. Does the jury pick up on that? Who knows? However, in an appropriate case, there is nothing wrong with a lawyer in final argument to the jury saying, you're going to hear the judge instruct you in a few minutes on your decision. And the judge is going to tell you this. And the lawyer can argue that subtle distinction to the jury. No judge is going to stop that argument. Now, a lawyer is not going to use it except in an appropriate case. You have to make a close call where the nullification would be appropriate. And that instruction that I read is a jury nullification. It's still mandated. But again, there's a question under the recent case of whether that jury instruction is a core adjudicatory function. The second issue I can raise, tell you about, but can't answer, you've already heard about, and that comes from the State v. Paul case, which construed the current version of the statute, I believe passed in 2012, which the court held in Paul is not a jury nullification. In Paul, there is language that if a jury nullification statute is construed as giving the jury the right to judge the law, there is a significant question as to the constitutionality of such a statute. The court in the Paul case, which, by the way, if you want to look it up, is 167 New Hampshire, page 39. In 2014. In that case, the court cites an 1843 case, Pierce v. State. And in the 1843 case, the court said it is inconsistent with the spirit of the Constitution that questions of law should be decided by the verdict of the jury. They also cited State v. Hodge, which is an 1869 case, which said that judging the law by the jury is held to be illegal and unconstitutional. Now, courts in 2014 don't usually cite 1843 and 1869 cases. Occasionally it happens. But my knowledge of the court, both as a practicing lawyer, and I argued 10 cases before the court in my day as a lawyer, a trial lawyer, and I have obviously worked there now for 32 years. Courts don't cite 150-year-old precedent unless they're sending a message, usually the case. Of course, they would make decisions, and because they have to make decisions, I can't say one way or the other what the decision would be.
Okay, thank you for your testimony. Are there any questions for Mr. Zippel? Senator Gannon.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Again, I go back to one, line 14. So you quoted H.B. Wentworth and you were, the word should, if I was on a jury, that, so the Wentworth,
yep,
that we just were talking about,
yep,
should, I would think most, wouldn't you think most people are gonna be like a horse, you're getting led to the well, should, yep, I'd assume he's guilty. Whereas in the text here, that word may makes me think about it more. It's an open-ended thing.
There's, as I said, a subtle difference. It's not a hammer in the current instruction. But again, in an appropriate case, when the case is appropriate for potential nullification, I come back to the fact that a lawyer can argue that in closing argument and draw that attention to the jury and say it should. And perhaps give the definition of the word should. It's not a mandate, it's a should.
Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Any further questions? Seeing none. Thank you very much, Mr. Zippel. Okay, the chair will call Ian Freeman.
Good morning. I'm Ian Freeman. I'm one of the board of directors, members on the New Hampshire Jury Rights Association here. The website is nhjury.com. And last night, as I was falling asleep, I thought, I need to bring some flyers for the committee, and of course I completely forgot rushing out the door this morning. But I frequently am seen in front of the Cheshire County Courthouse, and there are actually jury rights activists at probably about 9 of the superior courts on a monthly basis, handing out information to potential jurors who are walking in the door, informing them about jury nullification. I've been doing this work for approximately a decade here in New Hampshire, and what I find is that the potential jurors are generally, probably about 90 to 95% of them that walk in will accept the flyer and are very grateful for having information about their rights that, in a lot of cases, they're not going to receive from the court. Now, as the gentleman who was just speaking argued, the attorney in New Hampshire does have the ability to talk about jury nullification. And that's one of the things that makes New Hampshire a really special place, because in most states, if you even broach the subject of jury nullification, you're looking at potential contempt of court or mistrial. So it's great that we have the ability to even talk about this in a courtroom, because that's pretty unprecedented. But one of the reasons why this is such an important piece of legislation is because the other one that sort of was gutted by the Supreme Court when they said it wasn't a jury nullification statute in the Rich Paul case, essentially it just doesn't go far enough. And I was there, actually. I was there for the whole thing. I saw the entire Rich Paul case. I was recording. There's full video of that particular case. I recorded the Supreme Court hearing as well, so I'm pretty intimately familiar with that. I know Rich Paul. He's a friend of mine. What's interesting was that the judge, when he was giving his instructions to the jury, the way he read the instructions was very telling. And I don't have the exact quote, but basically what he did was, when he put emphasis on certain words, he would say things like, you must interpret the law as I instructed. Put a real heavy emphasis on me, judge. I'm sitting up here, higher up than everyone else. I have this robe. I have, you know, these men at my behest. So even though the lawyer can make the argument, the judge gets the final statement to the jury. And the fact is, he seems to be the authority, much more so than the attorney. And so I don't think that, whatever it is that the attorney says, look, you know, jury, don't listen to what the judge says. This is what the truth is. And then the judge says, you do what I say. And then he's got a guy with a gun standing next to him, right? So I think that the jury is going to pay a lot more attention to what the judge says in that case. So I think that's why this is an important bill, because it makes it clear what that judge has to say if requested. So, you know, it's only if the defense requests it, although I would argue it should be in every case. At the very least, this is definitely moving in the right direction. Let's see. Mr. Horgan was up here saying that it's interesting that he was arguing against this, saying the jury should be applying the law and only the law. Well, I think that the jury needs to apply their conscience in a case as well. In fact, the New Hampshire Constitution has a right to our conscience. And so this essentially informs the jury of the right to use their conscience rather than just having to be these mindless triers of fact. They should be, and the intention of the jury was, beyond being our peers, they were also supposed to be the final check and balance on an out-of-control government, on a legislature that either through ignorance or malice has passed laws that are wrong. And we certainly know that the legislatures in the past have been wrong. Look at the Jim Crow laws, for instance, is a good example, or laws that forced slaves to be returned to their masters in the South. Obviously, I'm giving you examples of the South, but there's plenty of laws on the books here in New Hampshire. I think of one, in fact, I believe hasn't been repealed, that makes it illegal to play sports on a Sunday. Thankfully, we don't have the police out arresting Little League, you know, players and their coaches on Sunday. And hopefully, if the police did go out and arrest, you know, the Little League team, the jury would be given jury nullification instructions, and the jury would laugh the prosecutor right out of court, rather than blindly applying the law. And so again, anything we can do to help the jury understand this particular right is a really important concept, because right now the deck is stacked against the defendant. You've got the prosecution and the judge, they're both being paid by the state, they both have an interest in sort of protecting the status quo, protecting the state. This puts a little bit more help on the side of the defendant and gives the jury the right to really understand their true role as not just the trier of fact, but the people who have the conscience to make the decision to, in just that instance, say, this is a bad law, we're gonna overturn it right here. And a really bad law, like let's say the laws against cannabis, could be overturned more consistently, and eventually the word might get up to the legislature, like, hey, these prosecutors can't even get a conviction on this stuff. I remember one more example, case of Weed Clause. His name was Bob Constantine. This older guy, probably late 50s, in Grafton. He was growing some marijuana in his house. Somebody snitched on him. Cops came in, raided his home. He was using it for medical purposes. But regardless, even if he was using it just to get stoned, it's his business. He wasn't hurting anybody else. And the jury in that case was able to nullify. They didn't give him a complete not guilty, but they brought him down from weed manufacturing charge, or drug manufacturing, to a simple possession. So he went from a felony all the way down to a misdemeanor because the jury knew that what was happening to him was wrong. So thank you for listening. I'm happy to answer any questions. I've got a decade of experience in jury rights.
Thank you very much for your testimony, Mr. Freeman. Are there any questions from the jury? Seeing none?
Thanks.
Thank you. The chair will call Jay Noon.
Good morning, I'm Jay Noon, and I support the right of the jury to determine the application of the law. I feel the jury determining the application of the law is a very important element of jury nullification. Supreme Court justices, as far back as John Jay, for example, who I believe was the first Supreme Court justice in the United States, is quoted to saying, the jury has the right to judge both the law as well as the fact and controversy. Harlan F. Stone, who was the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court in 1941, is quoted as saying, "The law itself is on trial as much as the cause which is to be decided." I feel that this bill clarifies that the jury may be able to determine the application of the law, which a lot of jurors, I feel that, you know, people just pulled out of their regular jobs, go do jury trial for a day, don't realize what jury nullification is, never mind that they have a right to nullify the law. When I first learned about the rights of a juror as a young boy, it was taught to me that the jury is the final and fourth, or the fourth branch of government, essentially, the final check against bad laws and tyrannical laws. For example, jury nullification was used in the laws where the Fugitive Slave Act was brought against people who were, you know, transporting slaves out of the South into the North, or, you know, harboring slaves, for example, and they did disregard the instructions of the judge, and they literally thought that law was bad, even though these folks were clearly in violation of the Fugitive Slave Act, and they found them not guilty. And that is about all I have to say.
Thank you very much for your testimony, Mr. Newman. Are there any questions from the committee? Seeing none, thank you very much. The chair will call Joseph Tessier.
Good morning, Madam Chair.
Good morning.
Members of the committee. My name is Attorney Joe Tessier. I'm a police prosecutor for the Hudson, New Hampshire Police Department, and I'm appearing today on behalf of the police in Hudson. I'm a resident of Milford. I've practiced law since 2008. From 2008 to 2013, I was a public defender. From 2013 to present, I've been a police prosecutor. So my knowledge in terms of what's been going on in the Superior Court since 2013 is very limited. But I do work with the police in referring cases for felony prosecution and misdemeanor appeals that are heard in front of juries. Our concern here is that 130, and I'm testifying in opposition to 133. Our concern here is that 133 empowers a jury to sit in judgment of the law or ignore the law. The Wentworth instruction that was talked about today is subtle, and I believe it needs to be, because anything more would encourage waiver of statutes. In an appropriate case of obvious injustice, that subtlety in the Wentworth instruction becomes persuasive, but only when that injustice is obvious. Protections against injustice, we kind of heard about this today, could be additional legislation, changing laws, judgment notwithstanding the verdict, also prosecutorial discretion. Looking at cases, looking at the entire picture, and deciding when to charge and when not to charge. There is, in the Wentworth decision, there's some language that cautions any further refinement of the Wentworth instruction. It says, "We caution our trial judges to avoid attempts at further defining reasonable doubt. In many instances, further definition leads only to further complication of needless litigation." And I think that's the concern here. Anything more than a Wentworth instruction encourages waiver of laws. I have an additional concern. The law is proposed. It allows juries to evaluate whether the result will be just or unjust. A lot of times, juries aren't going to get the whole picture. The New Hampshire Rules of Evidence limits prosecutors from, let's say, in a domestic violence case, talking about all the other times there was assault in the past. And maybe this jury is just looking at this one push, this one domestic violence push. And if they're gonna sit in judgment of that law, they could reach an unjust result because they don't know all that history that happened beforehand. The only people that are gonna know that is the sentencing court, right, or the prosecutor deciding whether or not to bring the charge. Here's my testimony here today in opposition to 132. I'm open to any questions.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Are there any questions? Seeing none, thank you very much.
Thank you.
The chair will call the final speaker, Dan McGuire.
Good you very much, Madam Chair, members of the committee. My name is Dan McGuire. I'm from Paxson, and today I'm representing the New Hampshire Liberty Alliance. Mr. Zippel sort of downplayed 150-year-old precedent, so I'm going to be even worse. I'm going to talk about 350-year-old precedent. The historical basis for House Bill 133 is really impeccable. It can be traced back to a case that was instrumental in very fundamental rights being recognized. Rights of freedom of religion, freedom of assembly, and jury rights. The case involved a fellow named William Penn, 1670, who was a Quaker, and he and a friend of his were preaching to a group of people about their religion, about Quakerism, and that was against the law. There was an official church, Church of England. Quakerism was illegal, and in particular, the way the law was written at the time, they couldn't assemble to preach this false religion. And so the guy was, William Penn was arrested, put on trial, and the judge in the case directed the jury to bring a guilty verdict, because it was so cut and dried, and the jury refused to do that. So the jury found Penn and Mead not guilty. And the judge was so upset about that that he put the jury in jail for 2 days with no food or water. And then when they brought him back, they still refused to find him guilty. And so the judge fined the jury a large amount of money, and apparently it was equivalent to about a year's wages, and put them in prison. And finally, they got themselves, the jury got themselves a trial, that judge, you know, sort of cooler heads prevailed, and that judge wrote a ruling which established that jurors could not be put in jail because someone disagreed with their opinion, so with their verdict. All right, jurors can only be put in jail if there's some kind of, you know, bribery or malfeasance or bullying or that sort of stuff, but not because the judge just simply disagrees with the verdict. And so that case established a lot of things. It established the absolute right of juries to come up with their verdict however they do so and not to be criticized for it. And secondly, it established the right of freedom of religion and freedom of assembly and that sort of thing. Penn later went on to found the state of Pennsylvania and the city of Philadelphia. And if you go to Pennsylvania's constitution, it's very strong on freedom of religion and so on. So the basis of this is very, very important, is very sort of historically important. Now, I want to talk a little bit about some specifics that seem to have been brought up earlier and a little confusing. First of all, what this bill contains is exactly what Mr. Zippel read as the current set of instructions with one additional sentence. So the first two sentences are identical. Then the last sentence is new. And the first two sentences, as you've talked about earlier, is about should and shall and ought and may and all that. And I just don't see why would we want a jury to be somehow, why would we want to be vague to a jury about what their powers are and what their duties are and so on? We want to be clear, right? And to force them to somehow, I would agree that without this final sentence, it doesn't change what their power is, right? The word should does mean that they sometimes could go some other way. But why are we being vague? Why, you know, it's something like if juries have a certain right, they ought to know what it is. They ought to know what they're you know, there's no point in somehow being vague or confusing or so on. So that's the point of the final sentence. is to say, if the facts in this particular case, and I find that word very important on line 13 here, based upon the facts of this case, so if something about the facts of this case says that guilty verdict is not correct, then you can find the jury, the defendant, not guilty, right? So for example, I could go back to Representative Itzi's example of the husband who, his wife was stricken with cancer, he gave her extra drugs, she died, and so on. Well, if I twist those facts a little bit, maybe the jury would not be so sympathetic, right? What if the husband inherits a significant amount of money upon the death of his wife? What if the husband is shown to have some affair or something like that, right? So changing the facts changes what would be decided in a given case. And that's the key. That's what juries are there for. Because as legislators, you can't possibly know every single case, all the little details. There's certainly edge cases between a guilty action and a not guilty action and so on. And the jurors are there to listen to it and to make that decision. And finally, to what Senator Gannon brought up about, well, wouldn't one jury maybe make a different decision as another jury? And of course, that's inherent in the system, you know? But the whole reason why we have a 12-person jury and we require that they be unanimous in cases of sending somebody to jail is that we've made the decision that it's much worse to send an innocent person to jail than it is to let a guilty person not go to jail, right? So we twist, emphasize or we skew things such that a lot of things have to happen before somebody goes to jail, right? The legislature has to decide this is a guilty action. The governor has to agree with the legislature. The prosecutor has to decide that this person engaged in that guilty action. The judge has to agree that this is a proper trial. And all 12 people on the jury have to agree that, yes, that person was guilty, right? So there's a lot of steps involved. And it's true, you know, maybe in one particular trial, one of those people would have made a different decision and so on. But that happens. And it's just, we want juries to know what their powers are. And we want them to make the just decision. It's as simple as that.
Okay, thank you for your testimony. Are there any questions? Seeing none, thank you very much. We're going to go ahead and close the public hearing on House Bill 133.